Recently, Stoiker invited along to the Python office in Regent's Park to discuss the life of Michael Palin. Well, Michael, you began writing and appearing in reviews whilst you were reading history at Oxford. Mm. Had you always wanted to write professionally, or did you just drift into it whilst you were at the university?
I drifted into it whilst I was at university. I mean, I wanted to be a film actor, a cowboy. I mean, one of those sort of heroes on the beaches of Dunkirk and all those films I'd seen. And I wanted to write comedy as good as Tony Hancock and as Galton and Simpson had done for Hancock and Milligan had done for the Goons. I wanted to do all these things, but it never seriously entered my head I might stand a chance of doing it until halfway through my time at Oxford.
In fact, I believe that at that stage you feared you might have to earn your living in advertising.
Yes, advertising was the only alternative to Pilkington's Glass, which was the company which our careers master at school advised anyone to go into. You'd go along for a careers talk. And he talked to you for about 20 minutes and always reach in the desk and say, well, I think you should consider the possibilities of working for a firm like this. And I'll become this little brochure for Pilkington's Glass. Anybody, you know, even if they were a sort of classical scholar or a chemist or whatever, would be asked to join Pilkington's Glass. But advertising seemed to be, it was either advertising or journalism, because both of them involved writing, and I did enjoy writing a lot. But acting, I was not, had not really seriously considered because of my parents' opposition to such frivolity.
You first met Terry Jones at Oxford, didn't you?
Yes, that's right, yes.
And you worked together writing reviews at that time?
Well, not a great deal at Oxford. It was mainly afterwards. I worked with a guy called Robert Hewson, who's now, I think, the assistant critic of the theatre critic of the Sunday Times, and an author. And he and I met up on my very first day at Oxford, and he really got me into doing review and cabaret, and I wrote most of my early stuff with him. And then I performed with Terry in a review in 1964 up at Edinburgh, and I think it was after that that we started doing a little bit of writing together, but really not until I left. Terry, you see, left in 64, I left in 65, and he was busy putting together a thing called The Love Show, which was a theatrical documentary about sex. Theatrical documentary, very, very popular form at the time, a sort of committed theatre. Sex was very popular too.
But, as ever.
Terry wanted to combine the two, and he asked me if I would help him write it.
Presumably, then, you feel that you're in your ideal vocation now?
Well, I'm lucky, yes. I'm very happy doing what I'm doing, yes. I keep thinking I might get found out. Say, hello, Palin. Let's see your credentials. What's this, a half-chewed history degree from Oxford? No good to anybody. What was the date of, Treaty of Nijmegen? I'd be stuck, you see. I
back really on university challenge type of thing.
So, I mean, I have always got through by humour. I mean, you know, that was a rather bad attempt at it, but trying to make people laugh to get out of trouble. So I suppose that if that's a vocation, then yes.
Even your early writing tended towards the zany type of humour now associated with Monty Python's Flying Circus. Was this your own personal preference, or was it just in the air at the university at that time?
No, the university, I chiefly remember, was then dominated by satire, the dreaded satire. You know, things had to be satirical, and it was then very brave and quite new to sort of pillory the Prime Minister of the day on television or in sketches. And a lot of the sort of establishment, the establishment nightclub, which is Peter Cook, ran in London, the Private Eye sort of area, John Bird, John Fortune, all those sort of people were doing very satirical humour. I think Terry and I actually began to write stuff towards the end of my time at Oxford, which was rather more whimsy, fantasy, character writing. And I think the direction began to change really around about the mid-60s, away from satire and being rude about the police, to being rude about the police, but in a slightly more sort of silly fashion.
Your first professional writing was done for the television programme The Frost Report. How did you actually make the step into television writing?
Well, that was the result of David Frost having come to see the review in Edinburgh, we did in 1964. Then he came to see another show I did in London. It was a very small nightclub, very unsuccessful show in about 1965 summer. He knew of Terry's work as well, And he obviously, you know, kept his ear to the ground and heard that there was these writers around, and we were rung up by Frost and his producer, Jimmy Gilbert, and said, well, we'd like to write this new series called The Frost Report, featuring the great man himself. And they wanted, you know, the brightest and best writers. Mm-hmm. They'd obviously tell that to everybody, because it was the longest credit list of anything I've ever seen in my life.
Yes, in fact, all the soon-to-be Monty Python team were writing for that
show,
weren't they?
Yes, they were all in there.
Yes,
in the end, it was a very. They had so many writers that, in order not to sort of take up the entire half hour with credits, they sent the roller caption through at a faster rate than I've ever seen anything go in my life. It was a real Ferrari of a roller caption, which is a great pity because that was the first thing I'd done, and I asked my mother especially to watch and said, "Look out for my name," you know, and she's vroomph. Said, yeah, well, David Frost was good. I can't remember anyone else.
Did you get to know the other members of the Monty Python team at that time? Or were you all separate teams of writers?
We were separate teams, really. I knew of John because he was in the cast of Frost Report, and occasionally we'd see him. It was all very hierarchical at that time. Mm. I can remember feeling very much the lowest of the low. And John was an established performer by that time, and very successful, and one didn't really talk to him unless he talked to you, sort of thing. Mm. So we sort of knew of their existence. Graham Chapman was a more shadowy figure, but all I knew is that he and John used to turn in these sketches for the Frost Report, which was superb. I mean, they were just absolute classics. And whenever a Cheese and Clapman sketch was read out at the script meeting, people sort of, there was a buzz of anticipation. Mm. So I was just an admirer. From then on, Eric, on the other hand, Eric Idle, I knew rather better because he was my sort of contemporary. He was at Cambridge, I was at Oxford. And he and Terry Jones and myself did Do Not Adjust Your Set together in 1967,
later on,
a writing and performing show. So we'd worked together quite a lot before Python. Mm.
Of course, you're still best known for your part in Monty Python's Flying Circus. At that time, it was a very original and quite radical form of humour. Where did the idea originally come from?
Well, from a genuine boredom with television sketch comedy as it existed then, which was very much beginning, middle and end, very sort of shaped conventional sketches, usually with a star or two stars to front the show. The 3 Degrees had a sort of singing break in the middle, you know. It was very, very, very settled, really. Even Frost Report, I think, had a singing break. Julie Felix, that's right. And I think it was like we were sort of suppressed, you know, something we wanted to do was being suppressed, and we wanted to be sillier and just enjoy ourselves and have much more fun.
You all felt the same way.
Yes, I think we all felt the same. I mean, no one ever really said that. Mm. But it's happened, and it's gradually, I think, also this sort of feeling of arrogance slightly, that we were capable of knowing exactly what a show should be like. Mm. Because up to then, the BBC had been the people who had initiated everything. I mean, there was someone at the BBC who said, this is what the show is going to be, this is going to involve so-and-so and so-and-so. With Python, it wasn't like that. We went to the BBC and said, listen, we know, trust us, please, we know we can do a very funny show.
And they gave you a
barefaced cheek, really.
Yes, I see. They gave you a reasonable amount of freedom, though, to do it.
Yes, they did. I think because, I mean, John certainly was probably our strongest card. They did know him well. At last, the 1948 show, which he had done with Graham Chapman, Marty Feldman, Tim Brooke Taylor, and others, had been a success in a sort of underground way, in the same way Do Not Adjust Your Set had been. So, I mean, it wasn't as if we had no pedigree at all, but you know, it was very, very good. I don't think any other television company in the world would have let us go ahead and do a show with less of a brief than we did for that.
Of all the members of the Monty Python team, you probably played the widest variety of characterisations. Did you base any of these on real people?
Yes, occasionally. Generally, you know, they were distilled from all sorts of people I saw around or just sort of attitudes, really. I like playing shifty characters a lot. And I had a garage man at that time, 1960s, who had a wonderfully sort of shifty manner. And anything that was wrong with the car, he would say, oh, well, bring it in, we'll have a look. And then I got a new car once, which everything broke. I mean, you know, the brakes didn't work, all that sort of thing. And I just went and said, well, tell you what, bring it in, we'll have a look. So I brought it in, you know. Yeah, oh, well, it's because it's new, you see, and all this. And he actually became the model for the pet shop owner, which John and Graham nice. Wrote up. So that was based on a real person, I suppose. Otherwise, generally just observations of people I see around, or very often people who appeared on television. I mean, Python was quite incestuous. It was very much about the medium itself and about television and about the sort of cliched performances people give on television, credits, music, all those sort of things that you see and you say, oh, no, God, when you see them on television. We had the chance to actually sort of then use them and make sketches around them and send them up.
Mm. In connection with those characterizations, you're quoted as saying, I don't actually like bright, sharp, clever, pushy people.
Oh, yeah.
Now, some people have said to me that the members of the Monty Python team were precisely that sort of person. How would you react to that?
Yeah, I don't like them. No, I think they're awful.
Mm. But you don't regard the members of the Monty Python team as being that?
Yeah, no, they are. Yes,
they
the
are.
The Python team, they're the worst. They're the sort of bright, flashy, successful gits I really hate. No, that's not entirely true.
Well,
they have the redeeming feature of being very, very funny and making me laugh an awful lot. So anyone who makes me laugh an awful lot, I like, and I forget all my other prejudices against bright, sharp, flashy people.
Oh, I see.
In fact, Python is not an outfit that glows with success at all. I mean, it's really... I suppose John has a Bentley, that's about all. It's a rather endearing group in a way, in that we're all sort of keeping an eye on one another. And the slightest sort of tendency to Hollywoodize our lifestyles is met by, oh, well, look at him, you know. Tax evasion and all that sort of thing is slightly sort of mocked.
Well, it's interesting you're saying that, because I was going to ask you about the breakup of the Monty Python team in 1975 after making Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Were you disappointed by that, or was it a relief?
Well, we'd actually broken up before, which led me to believe that there was never such a thing as a breakup in Python. It was just a sort of temporary leave of absence. You know, I mean, a temporary split up. What had happened in 1972, actually, was after doing three series of television shows, innumerable albums, books, and whatever, the pressure had become rather too much. We were living out of each other's pockets all the time. And John Cleese was the first one, I think, who felt that it was all getting a bit much and he had no freedom anymore. So he went off, and we actually did a series in 74 with just the five of us, without John.
Without John Cleese. Yeah.
So, you know, in a sense, that sort of that was the worst time. And after Meaning of Life, yes, things did seem bad for a bit, but it was a sort of stage you had to go through. It was getting to know each other in a much freer way. I mean, when we started, it was just, we were just so pleased to have the opportunity to do what we were doing. It was all fresh and new and wonderful. And then, I mean, after two or three years, Python became such an industry that it really was defeating the purpose it had been created for in the first place, which was to be fresh and have a fresh, new, bright approach to things. And in fact, we found we were stuck in record contracts, which we couldn't get out of, and that sort of stupid thing that normally we would satirise. So I think it was quite good that everything did stop every now and then.
So was it, in fact, getting a bit too stale and rather commercial?
It was tending to. It was tending to. In fact, it didn't in the end. And I think throughout Python's... the history of the Python group, we've actually always avoided becoming very commercial. I mean, the Python things do well, but whenever we've been offered sort of multi-picture contracts, not that's happened that often, but we have, or New York public relations teams have wanted to market us on television right across America and all that sort of thing, it's never worked. We think, oh, yummy, yes, rather exciting. Swimming pool time, hello, here we go, down the yacht, off can, eh? And then suddenly we meet Sir Irving J. Vercotti of this New York firm. You know, he's one of these characters again. Hey, you guys, you know, you're great, you're really great. His eyes shifting around all over the place. He said, we send up people like this, and here he is, you know, going to make us like, you guys, I can make you millions. We couldn't go with someone like that. So in the end, we end up, you know, here.
In your own offices.
Mm.
Controlling your own destiny.
You know, I mean, we're behind on the rent with it. No, I'm not trying to pretend we're poor, because Python is not poor any longer, but it does control its own destiny still, which is quite good, and is not beholden, I think, to any Lonro or and Rupert Murdoch anyway.
I see. Starting in 1976, you co-wrote and starred in the series Ripping Yarns with Terry Jones. The first of these was the highly popular Tomkinson School Days. Where did the idea for this actually come from?
Well, we'd been sort of, Terry and I had been thinking about what to write as a brand new sort of series. And I'd given Terry a book one Christmas called Ripping Tales, something like that. We give each other silly books every now and then. And his brother had seen it one evening in Terry's shelf. So why don't you do something in that sort of period theme? And so we started off and began to write a school story, sort of spoof school story. And it just wrote itself very, very... The first 20 minutes certainly wrote themselves very, very easily. So that was really how that began. And then the BBC liked it very much. And there was a bit of fuss and bother with them over who should be in it, because they didn't want any two pythons to be together, because it would be sensitive then, it would look like a python. And so he agreed to go ahead with me playing a sort of hero figure each week and casting it really not as python shows were cast, but you know, as if one would cast an ordinary sort of drama, getting the right person of the right age and sex for the part.
Did you find that you have always have this problem of being typecast as a member of the Monty Python team, and people expect to see a Monty Python film or TV programme or whatever?
Well, yes, it certainly is what you're most remembered for, and there's no way that one can avoid that, because it has been, it's been the most distinctive and individual and different of all the things that I've ever been associated with. But as a result of doing the Ripping Yarns, a sort of people, I think, and even silly things like doing that hour-long railway journey for the BBC, I mean, people were seeing that there was a side of that was sort of Palin-esque, in the same way that John had gone off to do Faulty Towers. And you could say, well, there's a sort of Cleesian offshoot there. And I think people accept that, and I think with the missionary, I tended to get more people saying, well, it's like Ripping Yarns than why isn't it Python? Which was, I felt, some sort of achievement.
In 1979, the Monty Python team came together once again to make the film Monty Python's Life of Brian. There was a great deal of outrage in the press at this time, and many people were all too ready to condemn the film without ever actually having seen it. What's your reaction to that type of attitude?
Well, I have to confess that we were quite excited by it. Yes, it was quite... It was nice to have stirred something up. But it was also extremely frustrating to be condemned by people who hadn't seen the film. That was the worst thing about it. And I thought the general level of debate about the film, I mean, was so low it hardly existed. I thought that there would be, there certainly were areas where we expected to be attacked from the, I suppose, the sort of established church. Might say, you know, well, you need priests or you need people to interpret the scriptures and all that sort of thing, which we were, I suppose, in a sense, saying we didn't need in the Life of Brian, but instead they went straight for the fact that it was blasphemous and we were sending up Jesus Christ and all that, which we weren't, and which we made absolutely clear we weren't, by showing Jesus in the film anyway to make quite clear that he was separate from Brian. But I think, so it was frustrating in a way that the general level of the controversy, but it was also, as I say, quite exciting in a way to be in the middle of all that.
Still in a religious vein, your latest film has been The Missionary, which you wrote and starred in yourself. Did this develop from the Ripping Yarns series?
No, it was in the style of Ripping Yarns. I almost had to, because George Harrison, who had given me the money for The Missionary, had really given it on the basis that he liked Ripping Yarns and that style of humour very much, and he knew that I wanted to do it sort of properly, as it were, not on a little telly screen with a telly budget, but on, you know, a big screen. So I couldn't stray too far from that, but it was fine. Yes, I wanted it to be roughly in that spirit, but to go a bit further than Ripping Yarns, not to be just a sort of literary parody of a sort of school tale or an escape story or a Yorkshire football tale like the Ripping Yarns were, but just to be, you know, a story in itself, an original tale.
Lady Ames.
Ames.
Mr. Forrester to see you, my lady.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Fortescue. I'm a missionary. I had the great good fortune of meeting you and your wife in London recently.
Never set eyes on you.
At the studio, sir. You're kind enough to be very sympathetic to my work.
Most unlikely. What sort of work is that?
Amongst the underprivileged, sir.
Who?
The underprivileged.
It's an unfamiliar term to me.
People who have less than ourselves.
Well, in our case, that includes practically everyone in the country. Can you be more specific?
Well, I certainly think we should hear more about it, don't you?
Leave the ungrateful buggers alone, I say.
Won't you stay for dinner?
No, I promised I'd be back this evening, before nightfall.
You missed the last train.
I was told there was a 4:22.
Oh, no, not on Thursdays.
Coach?
First thing in the morning.
Can't Willa get the motor out?
Well, not in this weather.
Then I'll walk.
Oh, no. No, really. It is far too far.
Can one buy a train?
Where would we keep it?
Look, really, I must get back.
Oh, one more for dinner, please, Millicent.
Yes, m'lady.
After all, it's not every day we have missionaries in this part of Wiltshire.
Did you have any particular reason for setting it in the East End of London? Was it a personal memory or something?
No, not at all. My only reason was, the only thing I wanted to do was to set it at the time of the British Empire, the heyday of the Empire, 1906, and show the sort of, the smartest and also the roughest side of society at that time. But it was really the Empire, the peak of the Empire was the period I wanted to use, because I thought, well, that's a nice area for comment and humour. You know, it always is when things are more formal, when people seem more confident and sure of themselves. I think that's when comedy is really...
Yes, you seem to be very interested in that period, the connected with the ripping yarns type tales. Is this a real interest of yours?
Yes. I mean, I'm interested in history much more now than I ever was when I read it at Oxford. That period especially I like because it's still within living memory. It's not quite distant suit of armour sort of history. There's an awful lot of source material. It seems to be much more relevant. You can see the buildings around. There are people still alive who remember that period. And yet, what happened before 1914 seems just so totally and utterly and completely different from the way we live now. It's as if, it's as different as the 13th century was in a way.
Your latest film is yet another Monty Python film. This time it's called The Meaning of Life. Are we seeing now the return of the old Monty Python tradition?
Oh, I think so, yes, very much so. It's, we tried after The Holy Grail and The Life of Brian. I think that we felt we were getting the grasp of how narrative should be written and how a sort of story hung together and a total sort of entity of a film could be made. And I think that was misleading, and I think it took us about 2 years of attempting to write sketches, attempting to write stories, for us to realise that still our strongest point were some inspired sketches. Yeah, some terrible things, but some inspired sketches. And that was what we were left with at the end of 1981, was a pile of very good sketches and no really binding theme. And we went away early in 1982. To Jamaica and sat on this long table by the beach and wrestled with this pile of sketches, tried to get them to some sort of order, and that's when the Meaning of Life idea came, and everything seemed to fit in, but it still is basically very much like the old television series, things happening all over the place, different periods of history, all of us playing many different roles, but men, women, dogs, cats. It's more like the old telly style.
So that should be very welcome to all the many Monty Python fans in around the world.
Well, I hope so. I hope they're still there. It's just opened in America and seems to have brought back Python fans into the theatres in substantial numbers. So, I mean, we hope it'll be the same here. Yeah, it's got some sort of good outrageous things in it.
The Grim Reaper.
That's about all he says. There's your drink, Mr. Death.
Do sit down. Would you prefer white? I'm afraid we don't have any beer.
The Stilton's awfully good.
I am not of this world.
Good Lord.
I am death.
Well, I
isn't that extraordinary? We were just talking about death only 5 minutes ago.
Yes, we were, you know. Whether death is really the end,
as my husband Howard here feels, or whether there is, and one so hates to use words like soul or spirit, but...
What other words can one use?
Exactly.
You do not understand.
Ah, no. Obviously not.
Let me just tell you something, Mr. Death.
You don't.
Just one moment. I'd like to express on behalf of everybody here what a really unique experience this is.
Here, here.
Yes, we're so delighted that you dropped in,
Mr. Death.
Can I just finish, please?
Mr. Death, is there an afterlife?
Dear, if you could just wait, please, a moment.
Are you
please,
sure you wouldn't like some sherry?
Angela, oh, I'd like you to say this at this time, if I could, please, really.
Be quiet.
Can I just say this at this time, please?
Silence! I have come for you.
You mean to...
Take you away. That is my purpose. I am death.
Well, that's cast rather a gloom over the evening, hasn't it?
Well, finally then, let me ask you what plans you have for the future. Is there anything you desperately want to do at the moment, television or film-wise?
Well, I must say that I mean, what I am doing at the moment is writing another screenplay on my own, and I'm also writing later on in the year a screenplay with Terry Jones. So the plan is really to make a couple of new comedies in the next couple of years. And, you know, I'm quite looking forward to that. But I've been a bit spoiled because there's always been something unexpected has come along. I mean, first they were writing our sketches pre-Python, then Python, which was a wonderful new world. Then Python seemed to dip, and suddenly we found that we could translate it to film with the Holy Grail, so we had a sort of little film career. Then I did one or two things like Jabberwocky and Time Bandits and Missionary, sort of on my own or with one other Python. And I feel I've done an awful lot of things that I've enjoyed. So now, really, the film I'm writing is, I suppose, to a certain extent, repeating something that I've done before, but it'll all be new. It'll be original script, and you know, I think it'll be enjoyable.
So these are all film projects rather than television?
Yes, I've got no television projects, apart from odd little things like bits for the BBC here and there, but no series or anything.
Well, let me wish you the best of luck with all those projects. Thank you very much indeed, Michael Palin.
Thank you. Very much enjoy being here in the University of Durham. Oh, sorry, Sussex. Oh,
London,
shit.
London.
Plymouth, Exeter, London.
Can you cut that bit,
Brunel,
Colin?
Brunel University. No, sorry. I thought, money?